A small percentage of the Israeli population, several thousand strong, they are united by religious zealotry and ultranationalism. They oppose Israeli democracy and any peaceful dealings with the Palestinians.
If we want to understand Rabbi Kahana, his message was that we need to go to war, because, in fact, what will bring our redemption is not prayer. What will bring redemption is war. But today we're going in exactly the opposite direction. Instead of war, there's peace now. There's an attempt to prevent war at all costs. And if we can force the army to go back to being offensive, an army of revenge, an army which cares about Jews more than anybody else, then we'll be able to bring the final redemption in the only way possible, through war. War now.
They were a warlike tribe that lived deep in the heart of Asia. And they were so warlike that even the Asiatics drove them out of Asia into Eastern Europe. And to reduce this, so you don't get too confused about the history of Eastern Europe, they set up this big Khazar kingdom, 800,000 square miles, only there was no Russia, there were no other countries, and the Khazar kingdom was the biggest country in all Europe. So big and so powerful that when the other monarchs wanted to go to war, the Khazars would loan them 40,000 soldiers. That's how big and powerful they were. Now, they were phallic worshippers. This is filthy, I don't want to go into the details of that now. It was their religion, the way it was the religion of many other pagans or barbarians elsewhere in the world. Now the king became so disgusted with the degeneracy of his kingdom that he decided to adopt a so-called monotheistic faith, either Christianity, Islam, Muslim faith, or what is known today as Judaism, really Talmudism. So, by spinning a top, he said, eeny, meeny, miny, moe, and he picked out so-called Judaism. And that became the state religion, and he sent down to Talmudic schools of Tel Aviv and Sura, and brought up thousands of these rabbis with their teachings, and he opened up synagogues and schools in his kingdom of 800,000 people, 800,000 square miles, and maybe 10 to 20 million people, and they became what we call Jews. There wasn't one of them that ever had an ancestor that ever put a toe in the Holy Land, not alone in Old Testament history, but back to time, the beginning of time.
And the blessing of Abraham come on every office, through every person that enters into that place. And that the blessing flow beyond any manifestation that any of these people have ever seen. And suddenly they will say, we can no longer turn our backs on the nation of Israel, and we will stand, and we will be firm, and we will win and not lose.
We killed Jesus, we're proud of
it. This is my land. This is not your land, it belongs to these families.
God gave it to
When the Zionism was, the whole movement of Zionism was created, the concept, the ideology of transforming Judaism from spirituality, a religion, into a materialism, a nationalistic goal to have a piece of land, all the rabbinical authorities said this is antithetical with what Judaism is all about, expressly forbidden in the Torah, because we are in exile by God.
Millions of Christians are holding up the weary arms of Israel's soldiers and giving hope to the tired souls of besieged Israelis. And it wasn't only that Pastor Hagee led them into this camp, but for so many of them, it was Pastor Hagee who taught them that their Bible demands they stand with Israel and that their theology requires that they act on this theological belief.
Implied that Israel has the right to exist because of what happened to the Jews during World War II. Why in Palestine? Don't the Palestinians too have the right to a secure homeland? Why do they have to suffer and make way for the Jews?
Look, we can go back and we can argue over the birth of Israel, the justice of the birth of Israel. We can argue over whether or not there should be an Israel. There is an Israel today. There's a strong Israel today, a vibrant Israel, that is not going to disappear. Palestinians have missed opportunities. There is an opportunity today. I don't see any useful purpose in arguing over what justifications Israel has to exist. Israel has all of the justifications in the world to exist. And I don't even think it's appropriate to question the reason why Israel exists. Thank God that there is at least one Israel, an Israel where Jews can live if they want to. They don't have to live there. But if they need refuge, if they want to live in a country that is a Jewish homeland, that's fine. And I think, as I said before, all of us should be delighted that we happen to be around at a time in this world when there is this Israel. To deny Zionism, to reject Zionism, is about as racist an element as you can get. Why should all of these people, Palestinians and others, deserve a homeland if the Jews can't have a homeland? Have not the Jews suffered enough all of the...
I suppose then it wasn't missed on anyone, the audience, that Mr. Glitzer was deploying that same familiar lawyer's tactic. The question that was put to him was, if we accept the legitimacy of the state of Israel, why don't we also accept the legitimacy of a Palestinian state? And then Mr. Blitzer went on to tell us all the good reasons why we should accept the legitimacy of the state of Israel, something which, by the way, I concur with. But that still doesn't answer the question. If one does accept the legitimacy of the state of Israel, why doesn't one also accord the same rights to self-determination and statehood to the Palestinians? That was the question, as I understand it, that was put to him.
Often when there is dissent expressed in the United States against policies of the Israeli government, people here are called anti-Semitic. What is your response to that as an Israeli Jew?
Well, it's a trick. We always use it. when from Europe somebody is criticizing Israel, then we bring up the Holocaust.
There are certain conditions, according to Jewish law, under which non-Jews may live here. This doesn't apply to the Arabs. They don't fit the category. They have to get the hell out. Whoever leaves under his own steam will save his own life. Whoever doesn't will have to pay the price. This is the land of Israel.
There are 54 million Chinese Muslims. 54 million. And Muhammad only died in 620 A.D., so in that time, 54 million Chinese have accepted Islam as their religious belief. Now imagine in China, 2,000 miles away from Arabia, where the city of Mecca is located, where Muhammad was born, imagine if the 54 million Chinese called themselves Arabs. Imagine! Why, you'd say they're lunatics.
Bat Ein live in enmity with their Palestinian neighbors, who don't dare come near. While other settlements are fenced in, the people here prefer a different approach. Deterrence.
The Arab knows that when a Jew fences himself in, the rest of the land is his. We want to prevent that. He puts his plow next to the Jew's fence and starts plowing all the way to his village. And that's unacceptable. If I don't have a fence, it confuses him. Our fence, in fact, goes as far as an M16 can reach. The range of an M16 bullet is our fence. Revenge is an important value. The Talmud says that it is one of the greatest things. Revenge is great.
Almost every one of the Psalms mentions revenge in one way or another. Usually people recite Psalms for the sick. In all of the Psalms there are maybe two verses about the sick. About revenge there are hundreds of verses.
And it is Pastor John Hagee who created the vehicle through which all Christians in America can act on their love for the State of Israel. Christians United for Israel, which, as you can see by looking around this room tonight, is rapidly becoming the most powerful Christian movement in the United States of America.
About 740 AD, the King of the Khazars converted to Judaism and made it the state religion. Incredibly, within a few centuries, the people of Khazaria convinced themselves that they were not Gentiles after all. Today, the Ashkenazim, or Khazars, are the vast majority, about 80% of those who call themselves Jew.
The Lord God has his hand on Israel, and God sends help for Israel when it is needed. Policy establishment in this country and in Europe looks at the dangerous situation and tells us the following. There are simply too many Muslims living on too much land, sitting on top of too much oil for us to risk alienating them.
According to author Simon Shama, the Rothschilds own 80% of the land of Israel. Even the flag of Israel flies the hexagram symbol from the Rothschild family's red shield. The hexagram has 6 points, 6 triangles, and 6 sides on the central hexagram. The numbers 666 are associated with the biblical prophecies.
Israel today faces greater threats to her existence than at any time in her existence since 1948.
Okay, so what do you call yourself? Huh? Como se llama?
The thing that we say to anybody is, let's cooperate and get this thing over with, and then we'll settle the differences once the crisis is over.
Such clergy response teams would walk a tightrope between the needs of the government versus the wishes of the public.
Because the government is established by the Lord, you know, and that's what we believe in the Christian faith. That's what's stated in the scripture.
Regnum meum non est de hoc mundo. Si eset, utas ministri mei.
In the 1930s, scientists wondered how Hitler could rule Germany and Stalin could rule Russia. These were vast territories. He could rule them with practically no army. And the answer was, they had discovered during the 1920s that adding sodium fluoride to the drinking water made the people very passive. Stalin found out that in his concentration camps, where you have to have guards, I mean nobody's there because they want to be, by adding sodium fluoride to the drinking water to camps, or the gulags, he could reduce his guards by an average of 4. You only need 1 in 4, 25% instead of 100%, which comes to quite a bit of money. Sodium fluoride is a byproduct of the manufacture of aluminum, which is a very complicated, well, you have it in Florida. It's a very complicated manufacturing process. And a byproduct of the manufacture of aluminum is sodium fluoride, which is a very dangerous chemical and very expensive to dispose of. So somebody came up with the imaginative premise that maybe sodium fluoride could be used to add to water, and maybe it would help prevent cavities in children in their teeth. There was never any study conducted on this, and no proof whatsoever that this was true. But Congress, with the judicious application of bribes, passed a bill enacting sodium fluoride in addition to water supplies all over the United States. And we haven't had a revolution since. And we had one party government ever since.
My friends, you are free. You are free to respect and appreciate the authority of the government that God gives to you. Honor the king.
To order a video or audio copy of today's message, I'm free to submit to authority. Visit our website or call 1-800-661.
You are the seat. Hear me. You are the focus, the seat of the adversarial antichrist. You are the chosen nation of God. Why are we here? Because this is now the focus of the battle. This is what you're calling the congressmen now who vote for Israel first and America second. because they say, I'm first a Jew. Oh, try me again? Mm. Is that a religion? Is that a race, a creed, a color? What are you talking about? If you dare say it's a color or a creed, you're anti-Semitic. Down with you, off with your head. The ADL will get you, you sucker, you anti-Semite. And not a single one of them come from the Semites. None of them. How can you be Israel first if you are a citizen of another country? So, again, look at the protocols. You don't even know where you are and who you are. I like to go right back to the term Khazar because that's what they were. And isn't it funny, once we came forth and we started hitting this, how many history books there actually are, and they are Jewish. The Jewish Encyclopedia, etc. Who has tried to hide this Khazarian history, just like they have voted in the Holocaust. Of course there was death. But the whole of Germany, for goodness sakes, was filled with Khazarians. And you had this same element footing the bill for the Bolshevik revolution while you had all this upheaval going on in Europe. To the point that that just about got lost in the shuffle. The same people funding both. Setting up both. And then the Jewish Encyclopedia gives the number of people of Jewish origin that they could call Jews. Long about that period of time as 6 million something. How could you kill 6,500,000 of them, which year before last they wanted to upgrade the number by 500,000? Well, they're still referring to 6 million, but very frequently you're going to see it written over 6.5 million. There were not 6.5 million of them. It isn't a matter of whether or not there was a thing. Mathematically, it does not add up. It could not have happened that way.
Why is it that those who ask questions are persecuted? Why such sensitivity or such prohibition on further studies on the subject?
So now you have the attack of the Anti-Defamation League. The Anti-Defamation League, my children, comes right out of British intelligence with orders from the Committee of 300. The ADL B'nai B'rith is the Jewish thrust which is most prevalent in the United States of America. They are the ones, on the other hand, that are now so active in Australia and Japan. So it's hard to say the Crown of England is doing that. Yep. And it's being enforced by an international police organization of the United Nations. ATF, BATF, Mossad, taken from Moses, KGB and whatever they're calling the new one, the new lie in Russia, and CIA. So they shift more KGB agents into the CIA than you have Americans. Mm. And they're all trained by the highly qualified Mossad. The Jews, the Khazarian Zionists, have been the terrorists since creation began. Why did you have the symbol of a serpent in the Garden of Eden? The Khazarians came along, took up the Judean religion because they didn't want Mohammedan. They didn't want Christianity. They were of those tribes. They were Russian, Mongol, and Nordic. Heavy, heavy Turkish accent tangled in there. The Khazarian Empire lasted over 300 years, and they infiltrated every nation on the globe. And they called themselves Jews. When they took up the Judean religion, quote, because they had the answer to everybody. They were warmongers. Everywhere they went, they were at war. They were the commercially controlling entity. They were the bankers. They were the commerce controllers. They would gain control and power everywhere they were. And just as they have handled the Holocaust by voting it in that you may not disagree, it becomes law. It got to the point that if you spoke of the things that I speak of today, you would be killed. And therefore, except in the books that were never intended to be brought public, ever, those secret religious books, Khazarianism was banished. Just like someday communism will be illegal to speak the term. Does that mean the systems change? No. After the Bolshevik Revolution, there were something like 20, 22 million Christians killed in Russia. I don't hear anybody bitching about that Holocaust. Oh, well, but the communists took over. Who were the communists? Every member of the communist government was Jewish. Hear me. Including Lenin. I cannot speak of the past of your historical lineage without telling you these things. And yes, people get killed for it. They don't want it out there because it's the truth. Why didn't you know about it? We had someone here who has been a teacher all her life. What do you know about the Khazars? Not one thing. And then finally, in reaching way back and then looking, checking, one small paragraph about Khazarians and a little bit about where they were in ancient times.
Those who threaten Israel threaten us. Israel has always faced these threats on the front lines. And I will bring to the White House an unshakable commitment to Israel's security. That starts with ensuring Israel's qualitative military advantage.
And word late tonight that two suspects are in FBI custody after a truckload of explosives was discovered around the George Washington Bridge.
We will stand with Israel. We want them around not just for 60 years, but for 600 years. And when I'm president of the United States, they will have an unwavering ally in me.
I'm aware that there's still some who would question or even justify the offense of 9/11. But let us be clear. Al-Qaeda killed nearly 3,000 people on that day. Even now states their determination to kill on a massive scale. They have affiliates in many countries and are trying to expand their reach. These are not opinions to be debated. These are facts to be dealt with.
And all of a sudden, down there, I see this van park. And I see three guys on top of the van. And I could see that they were, like, happy. You know, they didn't look shocked to me. You know, they didn't look shocked.
And at that point, we were taken for another round of questioning, this time related to our allegedly being members of Mossad. The fact of the matter is, we are coming from a country that experiences terror daily. Our purpose was to document the event. Our purpose was to document the event.
Before I was rescued and my mind and my memory restored, I was totally robotic. I had no ability to think for myself. I had no ability to question or to reason. I could only do exactly what I was told to do. One thing that I was told to do was to attend a White House cocktail party. This was during the Reagan-Bush administration while Ronald Reagan was president. It was on one occasion in particular that I heard Ronald Reagan talking with then Prime Minister of Canada, Brian Mulroney, who was also involved in this New World Order effort. And he said at that time that he believed the only way to world peace is through mind control of the masses. This is terrifying in proportion, especially when having experienced mind control, I know that there is no peace of mind under mind control. Without free thought, there's no free will. Without God-given free will, there's no spiritual expression. And I wonder, what kind of a so-called world peace can we have where people have no peace of mind, where they have no spiritual expression, when they have no, when they're not even in touch with their own identity? Or It's very frightening in proportion when we consider the ramifications of what all mind control entails.
Oh,
President Clinton was campaigning for his wife in Corpus Christi, Texas yesterday when an idiot started waving a sign that claimed 9/11 was an inside job.
That's not good screaming. Please
as Clinton was
stop.
Working the crowd after the
What's
speech.
What's Rosie O'Donnell doing in Corpus Christi?
The man got close to the former president and started yelling at him. You don't do that, you see, because that's when the Secret Service steps in.
The man led away in handcuffs
and hopefully taken one of those secret prisons in Eastern Europe, never to be heard from.
I bet that happens.
Okay. We can only hope.
If this were a dictatorship, it'd be a heck of a lot easier.
The family members at the 9/11 Commission asked hundreds of questions of the 9/11 Commission, questions that I wanted also.
I familiari delle vittime morte nell'attentato, negli attentati dell'11 settembre, hanno posto centinaia e centinaia di domande alla Commissione, tra cui tante domande che mi sono posto anch'io.
The Commission refused to answer them. Think of your son or daughter being murdered. Everyone think of.
Voglio chiedervi di fare una cosa molto difficile. Pensate che cosa vuol dire avere il proprio figlio o la propria figlia uccisi.
It's not about racism. It's not about antisemitism.
Non c'entra qui il razzismo, non c'entra l'antisemitismo.
I want the truth.
Io voglio la verità.
I've spent every day of my life since 2001.
E dal 2001 ogni giorno della mia vita.
Trying to find out who murdered my son.
On the Pinhead front, we are on the road again with Willie Nelson. The 74-year-old singer counts himself among the 9/11 conspiracy nuts.
What's your take on 9/11? Do you question the official story?
I certainly do, and I saw those towers fall, and I've seen an implosion in Las Vegas. There was too much similarities between the two, and I saw the building fall. It didn't get hit by nothing. So, how naive are we? What are they thinking we'll go for?
Good grief, Pinhead.
You know, it was sad because they didn't really take a look at any of the stuff I was asking them to look at, any of the evidence or any of the stuff that generated those questions, you know. And they said, he's another tinfoil hat wearing Hollywood clown. And there's two areas. There's Building 7 and there's the five frames from the Pentagon. Don't listen to me. Do your own research.
This is the kind of group that a Timothy McVeigh would come from.
Yeah, that's right. That's what makes it a little bit scary. Google any keywords like intentionally demolished buildings or buildings, demolished, whatever. You'll get hundreds of videos of buildings intentionally brought down. None of them fall like the World Trade Center buildings fell. They all fall from the bottom up, and the World Trade Center buildings fell from the top down. They all fall from the bottom up, and the World Trade Center buildings fell from the top down. Basically, where the planes hit is where they collapsed initially. So that one's easy to refute. Anybody can refute it. But the fact is, once it gets out on the internet, nobody fact checks. Nobody even looks that up.
And it has been in the hands of men ever since to investigate everything. The events leading up to, during, and the events post 9/11. I know on a daily basis the press covers the events post 9/11. But I feel, frankly, abandoned. If I question anything about the official story, I'm called a conspiracy theorist. My daughter was on the 93rd floor.
Being ex-military, when the attack initially took place and I was governor, I went on a very focused tunnel vision mode that our country had been attacked and what the hell do we need to do to repel it. So I today kick myself because at that point in time I had a position of power, and if I would have, not been the way I was, the way all of us were so shocked when it happened, that in that position of power, I could have raised a lot more questions at that time about the things that went down that day, and where today, when I raise those questions, naturally it doesn't quite have the impact that it would have had back then. But to me, it's questions that are not being answered and haven't been answered about 9/11. And, first and foremost, I think, is the fact that, in New York City and Manhattan, two planes struck two buildings. We'll all be in agreement on that, I think. But how is it that a third building fell 5 hours later? That's my first question. The 9/11 Commission never even brought it up. They didn't devote even one page to that in their big volume of investigation.
Anybody who thinks that 9/11 was carried out by the government isn't a truther. They're idiots. Can you actually imagine that our government was capable of successfully pulling off 9/11 and then keeping it off of the front page of the New York Times?
It was omitted. Building 7 9/11 report omitted. The entire thing, never in the history of the world has a building fallen from a fire into its own footprint, eliminating the core, 25 steel beams. Really impossible, physics-wise, impossible. Hard to say. Hard to say in America.
Personally, I think at this point, if anybody had a rope thick enough, I think that Rosie should be strung up for treason.
You would be surprised at how many people would rather be right about things than a lie. And they will set it up so that they can appear to be right, no matter who else they have to kill or destroy. And believe me, there are many, many things worse than death.
The Scholars for 9/11 Truth. These are the worst, most fringe, kookiest, discredited academic crackpots who believe that the Secret Service and the CIA planted a controlled demolition of that building.
Moments ago, I spoke to the chief of safety for the New York City Fire Department. He received word of the possibility of a secondary device, that is another bomb going off, but he said that there was another explosion which took place, and then an hour after the first hit here, there was another explosion that took place. He thinks that there were actually devices that were planted in the building. We are continuing to hear explosions here downtown.
Explosion and another explosion. We have a report now of a fourth explosion at the Trade Center.
We understand now there has been a secondary explosion on Tower 2.
And it's just been a huge explosion.
You want to call your mother or something?
I just want to, this is how crazy you guys are. And you guys are, really. Number one, you hate your country, and number two, you're a loon.
When a big plane hits a building, the building's going to come tumbling down. Do you think George Bush did it? Do you think Israel did it? I've heard so many sick, twisted conspiracy theories. Where are you leaning towards?
Did it, and neither did do you, and we need the American people to get the truth. We have a right to know who did it,
yeah.
And so do the families of the victims.
You know what?
What are you screaming about? Let him talk.
Support a new investigation into the attacks of 9/11.
Are you one of those that was an inside job, guys? I'll let you be rude and interrupt me. Scream at the top of your lungs. '9/11 was not an inside job. It was an Osama bin Laden job with 19 people from Saudi Arabia. They murdered 3,000 Americans and other farmers, including over 200 other Muslims. And we look like idiots, folks, denying that the people who murdered our fellow citizens did it when they are continuing to murder people all around the world. So we heard from you. You go away.
In most people's eyes, Israel is a terrorist state. It's the fact that you cannot comprehend that fact that leads to the bias which runs through all of your reporting and every question that you've asked me in this interview.
What we don't know is who may be responsible for these attacks. There's a lot of speculation, obviously, about Osama bin Laden, who is a Saudi dissident, who is believed to be harbored somewhere in Afghanistan, but no one is claiming responsibility. In the West Bank, however, the Palestinians in the streets are cheering and celebrating these attacks on the United States. The Palestinians in the streets are cheering and celebrating these attacks.
Thank you.
You wanted it to be blessed, and in your heart you know it to be true. You know what you gotta do.
Videotape, I understand that we're gonna show you from the West Bank. These are Palestinian celebrations.
The Iraqi regime continues to possess and conceal some of the most lethal weapons ever devised.
The main reason we went into Iraq at the time was we thought he had weapons of mass destruction. It turns out he didn't.
I know it's in Texas, probably in Tennessee. This says, fool me once, shame on you. If fool me, we can't get fooled again.
An axis of evil. Iran must end its support of terror, and it must not obtain a nuclear weapon.
The production and the usage of nuclear weapons is one of the most abhorrent acts to our eyes. In addition, we also believe that the atomic bomb has lost its use in political affairs, in fact. The time for nuclear bombs has ended. Whoever who invests in it is going the wrong way. Was the nuclear bomb able to help keep the Soviet Union intact?
Iranians are moving forward with their nuclear program quicker than expected.
The time for bombs of that nature has ended. It is a time of thought. A time for culture and reason to prevail.
Iran continued to defy the UN by refusing to answer questions about its nuclear program.
The largest number of inspections in the history of the IAEA has been done with the country of Iran. No country in the world has cooperated with the agency as much as Iran has done.
Do you believe there is a clandestine, secret nuclear weapons program right now underway in Iran?
We haven't seen any concrete evidence to that effect, Wolf. We haven't received any information that there is a parallel, ongoing, active nuclear weapon program.
And when I see George Bush standing next to a prime minister, Mr. Olmert, who has hundreds of nuclear weapons, illegally held, undeclared, not subject to any treaty obligations, thundering on about a country which his own intelligence service says it doesn't have any nuclear weapons and isn't trying to get any, it becomes surreal.
Iran is the central banker of international terrorism.
One thing could we do? Could we start arming the anti-government groups inside Iran? Could their cars start blowing up?
They have not found any documentation that would say that Iran has deviated from the peaceful path, or really those who are now developing the fourth and fifth generation of nuclear weapons and have historically, in fact, used the nuclear weapon.
And I hope it's not going to take another 9/11 to wake us up. 9/11 with weapons of mass destruction.
Stop letting them ride on your shoulders. Because when you come face to face with Maker, you are going to judge self on how many people you pulled away from their journey into oneness with God for your own selfish, greedy purposes.
The Bush community witnessing with outrage and anguish the perpetration of some of the plainest examples of crimes against humanity and genocide by an irresponsible and brutal regime that knows no boundaries in violating the most basic principles of international law, international humanitarian law, and human rights law. It seems as if the life of this criminal regime depends on creating of and persisting on bloodshed, and as if this regime feeds on nothing but war crimes, aggression, occupation, and state terrorism. People of Gaza continue to be subjected to untold suffering that are unprecedented in mankind's recent history. It is appalling to see that in the 21st century, the civilized world is witnessing that the whole population is under crippling blockade, starved, deprived of the most basic supplies such as even bread and drinking water, and at the same time slaughtered in one of the most horrendous ways while having been left with nowhere to go, nothing to eat, or no safe place to take shelter.
The destruction was horrific, and what was most shocking of all, the destruction was right in front of the world's eyes. This was not some hidden genocide. This was not some hidden massive atrocity. Everybody knew exactly what was going on. In fact, the European governments went along with it. The European governments went along with the starvation of Gaza the past 2 years. The European governments joined in the brutal economic sanctions against Gaza. And the European governments now, including the Russian government, they just went to visit Olmert after the brutality, after killing